Members, we've formed a quorum. May I call the meeting to order? Please be seated as soon as the possible, and please invite the administration to join us.
Oh, come on. Okay, do you like? Okay, done. Oh,
let us welcome representatives from the Education Bureau, Social Welfare Department, and Department of Health, as well as the Hospital Authority. The topic for our discussion is children's rights under the pressure of homework and assessment. Our next meeting is scheduled for the 18th of December at 10:45 to review our child care services, also a public hearing. You may wonder how much child rights are there under the pressure of assessment and schoolwork stress. You know, basic children's rights, including right to development, participation, and to be protected. How much rights is left amidst all these? And under the stress of schoolwork and examination, there can be a lot of problems, not only the mental stress of the children, and also the whole family can be affected. Last year, there was a report, a pediatrician and his team from Hong Kong UQMH Pediatrics Department found that in many child abuse cases, reported in hospitals were related to the exam season. When it's the exam season, there will be more cases appearing in hospitals. And recently, we had cases of bullies. SEN children encounter more difficulties in terms of schoolwork and assessment. We are very grateful that we have so many deputations and individuals present for this meeting. From the Education Bureau, we have only one, Mr. Zhou Ng, Principal Education Officer. As the chairman of the subcommittee, I find this regrettable. Of course, examination and schoolwork stress has everything to do with education, which is under the portfolio of the Education Bureau, and yet we have no principal, accountable officers, and none. We don't have the secretary, the undersecretary, the permanent secretary, and deputy secretary. None of them are present. We have only one principal education officer present. I would not belittle the significance of Mr. Ng. We have every respect for Mr. Ng. However, LegCo is the most important body representing public opinions. In particular, we have arranged for this meeting to be held on a Saturday so the school children can come here to tell us in person and make known their views to decision-making officials of the government. Unfortunately, none from the politically accountable team is present, and there is also none from the Bureau. So I really find this regrettable. Nevertheless, this is an open hearing, and there is live broadcast, and there is also minutes. So I hope that deputations and individuals will not feel too frustrated, because your views, your voice is bound to be heard by the public. And may I remind you that your submissions are not protected by the Electoral Powers and Privileges Ordinance. You have to be liable for your own speech. Each party will have 3 minutes. I don't think I really need to invite the Education Bureau to brief us on the paper. After all, it's just a rehearsal of what kind of support is available for members. I'll go into the deputations direct. Mr. Leung Yew-chung, I'd like to ask whether you have invited the secretary and the permanent secretary or any of the officials to be present. Well, we sent our invitation to the Education Bureau. I was expecting that someone would be present. Can we ask for a written explanation from the secretary? How come he was not here? And then there is no PS or DS or undersecretary present. Yes, I think we can do that. Now, I don't look down upon officials present, but then we have so many deputations and parents and children here to express their views to the secretary, and yet he is only sent one of his officials here, and this is not enough respect and regard for the whole matter. There must be a written explanation from the secretary himself. Thank you. Any views from other members, Mr. Xu Ka-chun? Chairman, this topic is rights of children amid examination and schoolwork stress. I'm also concerned about the stress faced by officials. I don't know whether we've jumped to the conclusion too hastily. Can we ask Mr. Ng to tell us, as far as he knows, whether the secretary, the undersecretary, the PS, the DS and PAS have other important engagements. Mr. Yip King Yim, I share the views of members. On this matter, we must have someone who has some say in the Bureau to be here personally to listen to views from the deputations and then respond to their comments. Of course, we don't look down upon officials present here, but to a certain extent, they are not in the policy-making positions. They can provide information on certain matters, and when there are new developments, they may be able to contribute. However, it is important that someone from the Bureau be present here to listen to views personally. And I think that is an unshakable responsibility, and it is regrettable that none of them are present. I think your views are heard. Dr. Cheng Chung Tai, I'm of the view that we must have a written response and explanation from the secretary. Mr. Ng is here. We understand that he is a principal education officer, but he is the most junior of the directorate grade. So I don't think he is involved in policy making. Usually in past public hearings, even though with in the presence of more senior officials, the Bureau would not change its position. But we don't even have a senior official here today, so I think the Bureau must be accountable to all of us here and also members who are concerned for this subject. Mr. Ng, yes, thank you. I understand that members would like to know whether senior officials of EDB have other commitments. Of course, I don't know the agenda.
But indeed, I understand that there are certain functions that other senior officials will have to attend today, but then I don't have the details with me. Thank you. Well, just now, Dr. Chiang Chong Tai asked for a written explanation, and Mr. Xiu Ka-chun also asked for a more detailed explanation. Mr. Xiu, you have do you have anything to add? Yes, I think Mr. Ng hasn't finished. So you don't know exactly where the four senior officials have gone. So you only knew that they had other commitments, and yet you didn't know the details. But then can you exactly tell us where the bureau director, the undersecretary, the PS, and also the DS, and where they have gone? Mr. Ng? Sorry, I'm afraid I don't exactly know where my co-workers have gone. But then you'd know they have other commitments, because I know that sometimes we'd also help them with drafting speeches for ceremonies and so on. I understand that some officials will have to attend other functions today. So if you've seen the speech, then you'd have some idea as to what kind of events those are. So you only know that they had other commitments. So can you exactly tell us what kind of activities they are? Well, these are open ceremonies, it's competitions and award presentation ceremonies and so on. So are you referring to the Bureau Director? It's the Undersecretary, okay? Mr. Lang Yu-chong? Chairman, during the last term, we criticized the Bureau Director for traveling a lot, or he might be attending functions which are which were apparently of less importance than meetings of this council. So is it that the Undersecretary, I think after listening to our comments last time, she has changed and now she is preferring those ceremonies and activities to electrical meetings. So is it necessary for her to attend? Well, this is a rare chance that we have so many deputations and parents who are here to give us their views. This is the most precious opportunity that we can have. How nice it is to have so many people gathering together to give us their views. So for presentation ceremonies and so on, the most you can get from those would be just some ceremonies and celebrations and so on. And yet you prefer that to this meeting, because this has a lot to do with policy makings. And for those competitions and prize presentation ceremonies, what have they got to do with policy making? So I don't think that's justifiable. If that's the case, then I think this committee should reprimand them for blatantly ignoring public views, because this is most important when compared to other events or functions. Unless you say that you are the keynote speaker, and the function has to do with your policy, that's why you have to go there. That would be acceptable. But then I don't think it's hard to find a replacement to attend those ceremonies. And you're talking about so many senior officials. There are so many contests and competitions today. So what kind of activity is the Bureau Director attending today? What about the Undersecretary? So Mr. Leung, I think if they are not able to come up with a good explanation, then I think there is every reason for this committee to reprimand them. Yes, Mr. Lang Yu-chong has made this suggestion that this subcommittee might need to express its views on the representativeness of the ranking and also the official sent by the Bureau to this meeting, and he's of the view that we should reprimand them for doing this because the ranking of the official is too low. Ms. Claudia Mo is not something that may be necessary. I think it's of absolute necessity that we reprimand them, because this is a Saturday afternoon, and I understand that on Saturday afternoons usually there would not be official duties, but then why are we here for? Because we are trying to accommodate the parents, because they have their own work schedule, and this Education Bureau Director. Well, for public trips or business trips, all right, those are glamorous things, but then we're talking about children's rules or children's rights and children's well-being. They are subjected to a lot of pressure from examination and schoolwork and so on, and their schedule is even tighter than that for adults, and this is really very bad. And I formally would like to move a motion so that we should formally reprimand them. Okay, so let's defer to Mr. Ng, who will explain further. You said that you understood that Undersecretary would be attending a prize presentation ceremony. What kind of competition is that? So what kind of prize presentation ceremony is that? Is that a very important event? No, it's not the Undersecretary. It's the Deputy Secretary. I'd also like to clarify that is... Well, I don't have the exact schedule of each and every senior official of the Bureau with me today, and I have to clarify that there are other important events and functions that they have to attend today. So I was just speaking from my recollection and my impression. And of course, whether or not such information is entirely accurate, I dare not say so, because I'm just saying those from my recollection. All right, you have no idea as to where they've gone. You don't know their schedule, right? Correct. Okay, Claudia Mo and Mr. Liang Yu Chong both suggested that we should condemn or reprimand the Education Bureau senior officials for failing to attend our meeting. Yes, Mr. Yip Kin Yun. Well, Chairman, they are not able to come up with a justification. Maybe there are indeed very important events or functions that they have to attend. And if that is the case, then there should at least be a written explanation. So they should apologize to us for not being able to come. And the fact that they are not able to come, and also they have not come up with any written explanation at all, then that's something that should be reprimanded. So at least they should come up with a written explanation. Yes, Mr. Xiu Ka-chan? Yes, I agree that there needs to be a written explanation, or else I'm worried that in the future, is it that we should never have public hearings or have meetings on Saturday afternoons? Because if it's a Saturday afternoon, both the Bureau Director, the Undersecretary, the PS, and also the DS would find it unsuitable or inconvenient to attend our meetings, then there is no point that we should ask so many people to come then on Saturday afternoons, because we all have to make some sacrifice before we are able to make it today. I'm sure those deputations who are here have also made certain sacrifices before they can come today. So I personally have other commitments that I have to give up. So I also have other engagements. I'm not just engaged to this. I have other work to do too. But then the fact that I'm here, it shows the level of importance that I'm giving this meeting. Okay, as chairman of this subcommittee, I'll be writing to the Education Bureau with regard to all the accountability officials, including the PS and the DS, or even assistant secretary. So none of them are here to listen to such an important public hearing. We'd like to express our regret, and we'd like to reprimand them for failing to come. So it's not just that they have not come, they have not even bothered to give us a written explanation. And if that's deemed proper, then we'll do it. And if you want to move a motion, then you'll have to write that down and read out the wording, or else I'll just write to them on behalf of the subcommittee, okay? Okay, so that's it. Now, let's move on to the public hearing proper. So 3 minutes each, because supposedly we should end by 4:30, but then we have already spent some 20 plus minutes on this item. So my apologies. First, Mr. Hong Ling Fai from the Civic Party. Thank you, Chairman. I'm also a high school teacher. So without any senior official here from the education bureau. I'd like to express my regret. In fact, at 11 this morning, well, I've been working on this and I've not even had the time for lunch. So as a teacher, in fact, that's our usual practice because thanks to the education bureau, our work has been very hard. And also for children's rights, when it comes to development rights, all right, the Education Bureau has ensured that there is room for our children to receive education. I think they've done a good job here. But then under Article 31, in terms of entertainment and also enjoy cultural activities and so on, well, apparently there is no protection whatsoever on these. So there might be PE classes, there might be activities organized by the school, and they think that by doing so, they have already arranged for children to enjoy such rights. But then we're talking about entitlements and rights. So how are we going to delineate between children's leisure time and recreation so that there can be balance between schoolwork and extracurricular activities? And also in the paper, you said that about 100 schools were surveyed, and according to the findings, well, within the same class, within the same, well, given the same kind of workload, the time spent could be very different. It can be up to 3 hours. It shows that, well, for frontline workers, because of the tight manpower situation and also because of the heavy workload, there is a lot of difficulty in making adjustments for individual students. But then you're passing the buck on to the schools, saying that the schools have not been doing things right, and as a result, the children are subjected to a lot of stress. Because if you look at the guideline, in fact, it's very vague. It just says that in dealing with homework, you will have to do so flexibly and organically. In other words, as to after school work, how that should be arranged, well, that would be up to the schools and also the families. But then for frontline teachers, well, we also have recommended class hours, and we will have to follow that. And under recommended class hours, if we have not been able to do that, then the progress of the children might not be able to meet the needs of the requirement of the authorities. But then how come there would be recommended class time, and what about the children? And there is no recommended homework time, and the Civic Party is of the view that we should look at the recommended school hours or class hours. We should also recommend the number of hours to be spent on homework so the teachers and also parents would be able to judge. And also in terms of examination pressure, they might have to take part in something that would have nothing to do with their education work. For example, P3 BCA, is there a pressing need for us to restore that in 2018? So the Civic Party would also like the administration to consider rolling that back. And also in terms of homework, the most interesting thing is that when it comes to public examination, they have reduced that from 2 to 1. But then when students have to prepare for university education, that would also be compressed from 4 years into 3. So the curriculum would mean that it would be more stressful. So can the teachers and also students decide whether or not they would be joining the school-based assessment? And we suggest that it should be up to the schools and the students. Next, Cheng Yusam. Thank you. Well, I'm a mom, and we are a parenting group, and I'd like to say something about the Children's Rights Convention. Well, under Article 29A, it says that the children's rights is that, well, their personality and also their ability should be developed and given full play. But then mainstream schools in Hong Kong are trying to suppress that. Well, from very young age, well, they are actually advocating that they should do a lot of drilling and so on, and for adults, even on holidays or weekends, they are not working. But then, well, the secretary is refusing to come, but then children will have to do their homework during weekends, well, for classwork and also examination. Many children have not been able to sleep for 9 hours a day, and if they are sick, then it would be even worse, because the parents will have to go to the schools to collect their homework, and then after the examination, if there is no homework, then the teachers will say that even if they are sick, if they fail to hand in their homework, that would also be recorded. So so they have been trained from a very young age that they will have to be very busy, or else they'll be done. And also there should be no mechanical drilling on writing and so on and so forth, or else there would be unnecessary stress and pressure. But then according to the students that I've come into contact with, well, in fact, during weekends, they will have to do a lot of homework. From Friday to Sunday, they will have to do at least one or two before they can complete everything. And then for my kid, who is at senior kindergarten, all right, he's more lucky. Well, he only has about two sheets of a worksheet. But then when I look at it, I was shocked because for a kid who doesn't even know how to read and understand any characters, he will have to write. And then when I complained to the headmaster, he said that he reviewed the situation, but then not all kids are so lucky because this school headmaster is very reasonable. And also for a P1 student who is a girl who is overactive, and then she has already chosen a school which is relatively less stressful, and she doesn't have enough sleep, and their emotion would also be affected. And also because she is overactive, she is an ADHD student, and therefore she will be subject to more pressure. And also during nighttime, they would also have to work. And according to some parents, well, when children are sick, and if they take days off or sick leave, then schools will ask them to go to the school to collect homework, or else they will have to finish everything over the weekend, or else they will be punished.
What I said was just the tip of the iceberg. Parents dare not reflect issues to parents and to teachers in schools, and children will still be suppressed. Article 31A of the UN Rights said that child has the right to rest and to engage in leisure, play and recreation activities, and participate in cultural and activities. Well, for the cases I just mentioned, which child has the right to rest and to engage in leisure activities? If adults cannot protect children, who can? Madam Chen Pui-Ching. I am Chen Pui-Ching from the Hong Kong Parents League for Education Renovation. I've got two kids, 1-7 and 1-3. For my son, as soon as he has entered primary, he is always in a rush. He gets up at 6:45, and then he can only rest at 6 p.m. And school lessons are from 7 to 3:50, and then he has to attend remedial classes, and he has to stay until 5 p.m. to attend Chinese remedial classes. We cannot withdraw, otherwise people will call us being unloving. I don't know why there are such parents in Hong Kong. Still, I decided to write to withdraw from the class because the class was useless, because if mechanical drilling can improve, there is no need for us, no one will fail. And I don't know why there are only 15 minutes of recess. They don't even have the right to rest. And children are really subject to great pressure. Take my son as an example. At midnight, he would come up and check, get up and check his school bag. He also wet his bed. He is already in P5, and yet he will still wet his bed because he's worried that if he hasn't completed his homework, he will be punished and he has to do corrections. Monday is a Chinese dictation, number 2 pre-dictation English, and number 4 English dictation, Friday, and all sorts of assessment. He spent his weekend preparing for dictations and tests. Since he entered primary school, he has no childhood anymore. As a mother, I want to help, but I have no other choice because all schools in Hong Kong are just the same. Lots of schoolwork and assessment and tests. We may want to go to another school, but it's even more difficult. There is no choice. In Hong Kong, we have close to zero schools that can enjoy happy learning. Yes, there may be other schools that are happy, and children need education that suits them. I know teachers find it a hard time to teach. Why do we have to spoon-feed our children so many things? As soon as you become a primary school children, you don't have quality of life, and there aren't resources in schools to help SEN children. The curriculum is the same for everybody, and if you cannot make it, then you stay behind at recess and after school for more supplementary exercises. Children don't even have the time to sleep when at home. They have to do 6-7 assignments. There is no end to that. As a mother, I can only sit by him and help. And he may cry, he is too tired. But can he say no? No, because he will be punished. So everything is about punishment and spoon feeding. I'm so sorry. I have to press you so much. We really don't have enough time in Hong Kong. From the same Parents League, Ms. Wong Lai Hang. Thank you. the Hong Kong Parents League for Education Renovation convener Mr. Chow Keng Han is otherwise engaged, so I have come on his behalf. Now, this is today is my daughter's birthday. This morning, she told me that her birthday wish was not to do any home any assignment, and he could have half day school. You may think that he has a lot of schoolwork. In fact, he is in a subvented school. He is among the very rare children who can have time to play and rest. So she has such a leisurely life, and still she wants to take a rest. She's not asking for a day at Disney Park or to Ocean Park. He just wants to have a day off from school. She's not greedy at all. And yet, this is already wishful thinking. And I think this is said when we were kids. We never asked for that. We didn't have to rush to do home assignments when we were kids. I'd like to take this opportunity to share with you. Now, I really want to spend time with my daughter. I have my priorities too. I fail to understand how come there is only one official from the Education Bureau and none of these are present. Is it that they do not attach enough significance to this issue? I hope that they can give us an account afterwards. All right, turning back to the mainstream, our Parents League did two surveys of all the schools in Hong Kong last year, and it's expected our children were under tremendous pressure. Now, and I think this has everything to do with whole-day education and the objectives of primary education. I urge everyone here present to take note that next Wednesday, our Hong Kong Parents League for Education Renovation will have a press briefing, and we tell you the actual statistics to tell you how bad the situation is among primary school kids and how much pressure they are under. And as for the guidelines from Education Bureau, they are not really binding on primary schools. Time doesn't wait for people, and every child has only one childhood. So I urge the Education Bureau to allow school kids to enjoy really whole day education. First, the guideline or homework should be reviewed, and there should be a time limit for home assignments, and then there should be sufficient time reserved in lessons so that children can complete their assignments there. And there should be consultation of parents, and the amount of schoolwork should be published at their website, and then there should be enough rest time in school for parents. I mean, for teachers and children, you have to ensure that schools will follow these guidelines. Thank you, Ms. Wong. Ms. Chen Xia, thank you. I'm also from Hong Kong Parents League for Education Renovation. I'm Chen Xia. My two daughters study in DSS school, and every day they have 3 to 4 assignments. And yet, the volume and complexity are getting more and more. My younger daughter has a tighter curriculum. I once asked at a teacher meeting where I can find out the homework policy, and she was at a loss. She said she had never heard of any assignment policy, and then she assured me that there were fewer assignments from that school and children should be able to cope. I was very surprised. The Education Bureau stressed that there should be proper communication between parents and schools, and then a policy on assignments should be uploaded to the website to enhance parents' understanding. And yet, there are teachers who have never heard of it, and so parents' right to know on a school's homework policy is denied, and the amount of rest time has been reduced from 75 to 70 minutes last year, and this year is further reduced to 65 minutes. I reflected this issue to teachers, and the reply I got was, well, when we changed lessons, there's rest time for children. And in fact, school time is very tight, and there is no time for children to write down their assignment book. And I've also received phone calls from teachers. They would recommend my daughters to join school teams. Of course, I feel happy because they're appreciated by teachers. Unfortunately, training would take place after school to ensure that my daughters have enough rest time. I've no choice but to give up diversity for my daughters. The purpose of whole day education is to provide a more favorable learning environment with diversity. Well, unless I am willing to cut rest time and quality time with my children, I have no choice. I have to give up the opportunity for training of or development of potential for my children. Many people may say that you are lucky. You're now in a through train school, and there is no rote training there, but rote learning there. And other schools are even more horrifying. We spent 2 weeks last month to do a survey of parents, and we've received responses from 266 real cases reflecting the heavy schoolwork, heavy workload faced by school kids. Thank you. Thank you, Chen Xi'er. Well, we used to have a genuine universal suffrage concern group. Now we have this genuine whole day education. Ms. Zheng Xi Yan. I am also from the same league, and I'm also the Alliance for Prevention of School Children Suicides. I have an open letter for submission to you, Chairman. Our secretary will help. Mr. Zheng, I'm sorry. I got your last name wrong. Before I start, I'd like to say a few things. Mr. Yang, the secretary, has set a very bad example. Mr. Eddie Ng, the former secretary, didn't attend public hearings, and Mr. Yang has followed suit. I believe they may be now in the Western District. I hope Mr. Ng can give us a written explanation later, and I hope that my guess was wrong. All right, turning back to the theme of this hearing. I'd like to talk about the relationship between education policy and examination. We all want to get rid of P3 BCA because BCA will not have any impact on the promotion or otherwise of our children. And yet, schools would like to ensure the ranking of and so they would drill school children from kindergarten to primary schools. They are drilling our children, and they don't even have time to play in the park. We're not talking about elite schools. Even in ordinary schools, there is a lot of drilling going on. We have done a questionnaire survey, and it shows that to ensure good scores, schools would increasingly drill students for BCAs. They are asked to do supplementary exercises in lessons, and this is very distorted and wrong. And the way of teaching in class is mirrors closely the examination or the test types of BCI. I'm a part-time tutorial teacher. I provide voluntary service. I have seen cases where parents forced me to provide more drilling to my students, hoping that they can get better results in schools, and this is counterproductive. Thank you. Ms. Lee Humo. Thank you. Good afternoon. I'd like to say this. My daughter asked whether I can go to, can I not go to school? I said, no, you can't. And she asked, Mom, can I take sick leave? I said, no. No, you can't be a dishonest child. You cannot fake sickness. But she said, I really want to be sick. So that's our way of life. We get up at 6:30, we go to school, and they come home at 4:30, and they spend 10 hours in school. So after a short rest, they start doing homework. There are about 8 assignments, and hopefully they can complete by 7 p.m.
So she already spends 12 hours a day on studying. So for those who are working full-time, so how many of you will be working 12 hours a day? And then for rest, my daughter will have about a 15-minute break, and then another break that will be about 20 minutes long. And then her classroom is on the fourth floor, and then when she walks up and down the stairs and also going to the toilet, that will take about 10 minutes altogether. And then she'll be able to take a break of about 5 minutes before she needs to go back to the classroom again. And then by the time after she finishes homework at home, for example, if she is able to finish by 7, then she'll have a shower, and then she'll have dinner, and then by 8 she'll have to reorganize her school bag, and then by 9 she'll have to go to bed. So there is no time for her to do her revision, because even during that hour, even if I force her to do her revision, she couldn't do it at all because she would be too tired, and she'd be so tired that she couldn't do anything at all. So the next day will be very much the same, and then by the time when it's weekend, on Saturday and Sunday, if you think she'll be able to rest, no, that's not true, because there will also be homework for the weekend. So for Saturdays, she'll have to spend the whole day on homework, and then on Sunday, I'll take her out for some activities. So every day, what I would be telling her would be that, well, there is no time, you will have to go to the toilet, please be quick. So be quick for this and be quick for that. And then after coming back from school, all right, I'll say that I finish your homework first and then go to have shower. There's no time. So where has the time gone? So I'd like to know that. Where has the time gone? I would very much like to see that, if all kids can do this together, all right, why don't we go on picnics? Why don't we go on walking? Why don't we have a walk? In fact, I'd like to thank all members here. So you've been able to organize this meeting, but then I heard that some officials have not been able to come because they have other engagements and commitments. I think parents have worked so hard, and I'm heartbroken. So what are you doing? So you're not working hard at all. So I'm really, really heartbroken. Yes, we've been putting too much pressure on the children, asking them to work so hard. Okay, next, it's your turn. It's Ms. Li Yut. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Li Yut. I'm a P2 student. Last year, when I was P1, I came here once, and I told you about how busy it's going to school, and there's a lot of homework, and so on and so forth. But then, still, there's no improvement at all. Now I'm P2, and every day there's still too much homework. I can't finish them. And then after I finish my homework, there's no time to play at all. So I hope that there can be more time to rest. And also there would be some time for me to play with mom, because after going home from school, I would be very tired, but then still I can't rest because I have to do my homework. It's really very tiring, and then after finishing homework, I'll have to do revision, because if I fail my test, then I'll have to explain to the teacher, and then the teacher would say that you will have to finish everything, and you will have to pass all the papers that you fail before you can continue, and then there'll be no rest. And every day in going to school, there are six classes, it's too many. And then when you're tired, you can't rest, you can't take a break, and then you'll be scolded by the teachers, and very often, I'd like to sleep. And yet, I hope that schools can give us less homework, and weekend homework would be too much. And then even though I don't have classes on Saturdays, I'll have to spend the whole day doing homework. And then when I try to exchange with my fellow classmates, I don't have time to mingle with them. We can only meet and play with one another during breaks. But then when will we be able to have more time to exchange views with them? All right, life is hard. There is no time to play. There is no time to get along with friends. I've been saying this for 2 years, but have you heard us? Have you heard the voices of the children? Thank you.
好, 多謝你啊, 李月, 我們聽緊你的...
All right, thank you. We are listening to you. Next, Mr. Yong Seok-ho. Well, I have three kids, 8-year-old, 6-year-old, and 5-year-old. All right, there is a primary school name. You have choices. All right, it's a whole day school. But then the classes would be in the morning. And then in the afternoon, it's just activities and also homework time. So that in the afternoon, if parents can come and pick up their children, then they can also choose to have half-day school, and then they can go back home after the morning classes. And then in the afternoon, they can be taken care of by their parents. And since the afternoon sessions would be shorter in time, so the teachers will be able to do a more focused job, so they can give more personal attention to those who stay behind. And then they can also provide guidance for them to finish their activities and also homework. So they should be able to finish most of their homework before they go home. And as teachers have more spare time, they can also make preparation for classes. They can also have meetings. So most teachers will be able to sign off at 4. And then for the mental and physical health of teachers, if they are healthy, then the quality of teaching would also be better. Another characteristic of this is that, but despite the fact that the administration will be announcing whether or not there will be a relaunching of BCA, but then for this particular school, parents have a choice. So even if the government dictates that they will have to take the examination, the school can also decide not to allow them to take the examination. They can just take their kids home without taking the examination. And then they can also decide whether or not there would be a merit or demerit point system. So on the demerit point system, you understand it all right. If there are 80 characters and if you make mistakes on one or two, then you'll be you have a few scores deducted. But then if it's a merit point system, all right, if you barely make 60, then you'll be able to get a high score. So there is no reason why you should fail if you do that. So for dictation, this is something that would be bothering all children every week, and parents and parents would also be subjected to a lot of pressure. So they adopt this new system. That is, it would be a merit point system. Well, some parents like more homework, and then for children, they don't like homework. So and they also have choices in the school. So they have stars. And if you don't like stars, you can also go for moon and sun. And then if you copy the text, you can also copy it twice. You can also copy it 5 times. So everybody will be happy. So they have a choice as to how much homework they'd like to do. So for this particular school, we don't have that yet. We need to have some policy so that all barriers will be removed. But then there is no budget implication. That can be done right away under the existing system. It's already feasible. So the parents will immediately have the choices. And if parents have choices, then our children will be able to enjoy their rights. Thank you. All right, for this particular school, it's a virtual school, right? Yes. I hope that it can come to reality as soon as possible. Because I'd like to know in which school will the teachers be able to sign off at 4. They will be disqualified right away. Fortunately, we haven't got that yet. Okay, we now have the Hong Kong Christian Services, Ms. Chu. Yes, I'm a social worker chairman. and I've heard from the parents and also children, and I find it really very frustrating. So it sounds reasonable that children should do their homework at home. But then, as you know, that would directly affect the motivation of students and also as to how much time you can enjoy and how much autonomy do you have after school. All right, there are guidelines from the Bureau so that there would be no drilling, so that they would be able to learn more effectively, and you'll be able to deepen that, and that's from P1 to P6. Regrettably, the guidelines are only guidelines. The schools will simply flout those guidelines, and there is no way that you have been monitoring how it's being implemented. Yes, on the face of it, there would be autonomy of the schools, and they would be looking at the actual need in arranging for homework and so on. But then they have totally ignored the situation of the students, and also they have also ignored the views of the students. They are not involved in determining this, and even parents are not included. So if you look at Hong Kong's primary school students, they've been forced to do homework. There is no rest and there is no break, and there is no way that they can play, they can enjoy their time. And even during breaks, as you can see from news reports, they only have about 40 minutes for rest. So should the Bureau be responsible for monitoring each and every primary school whether or not they have implemented the guidelines that you've introduced? And if there is one school that is not doing the job, then it's one too many. In fact, all schools have not been doing that at all. So you should be stepping up your efforts. You should be monitoring and making sure that every school will follow your guideline. Well, the Hong Kong Christian Service, in fact, in 2016, we do two surveys. It's about the perception of students and also their expectation on homework. And if you look at the results that we have collected, they describe it as something negative. So that rather that they do not do it and they find it very boring. And some 60% of the students say that, there is no positive thing to describe their homework. And some 40% think that it's very stressful, and that would also be the source of conflict with parents. And some 70% and also of students and also 60% of parents would support that there should be no homework, and even during long weekends there should be no homework. I hope that you listen to this. That is, both parents and students have very negative perception of homework, and that would also affect their motivation, and that would also affect the parenting relationship. So I hope that during weekends, in fact, the workload should be the same. You should not say that because it's a weekend and therefore schools should be giving more homework to the students, because that would affect their rest over the weekend, and that would also affect the parenting relationship. Well, even for domestic helpers, they have their weekend off, and yet children do not have that. And also, it's the first time that we have organized this no homework day, so that they would be able to learn by themselves, so that they don't have to do any homework, they don't have to do any copy book, and children do enjoy such a spare time. So why can't we allow them to spend their time on what they like during holidays and weekends? Instead, we are putting a lot of pressure on them, and they will have to do their homework during weekends. And also, the convention protects those under 18. In fact, if they have to go for tutorial classes, it's already overloading them, and they don't have summer holidays at all. So please give them back their summer holiday, so that high school students do not have to go for private tutorial classes. There are many things in life. It's not just about education and studies. So you should give them back their time, so that both primary and secondary school students should have more spare time, and they should also get back their summer holidays. Thank you. Mr. Kwok Wing Kin from the DAB. Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. I'm from the DAB. I'm responsible for education policy from the DAB. All right, examination and also homework stress. All right, we have all been through that. But then if you look at the pressure on the students, it's becoming heavier and heavier. All right, examination is a stress, and also homework is also very stressful. And also they're not able to meet the expectation of their teachers and parents. And if they're not able to ease the pressure, then if that's allowed to accumulate, there would be a lot of negative sentiments and emotion. So I have some suggestions to make today. I hope that you listen to them. First, we have to appropriately reduce the homework load, because it's just one aspect of education. The school should not be drilling the students mechanically, and they are forcing them to memorize everything. In fact, you should have attached importance to allowing students to learn on their own, so that they would be able to build their own confidence, so that they would be able to evaluate themselves more positively, and there should also be more guidelines from the Bureau in order to reduce the homework. They should not spend more than 30 minutes on homework, and for secondary school, they should not be spending more than 16 minutes on copying text and so on. And there should also be no homework days, and schools should also arrange for students to finish their homework while they're at school, so that by the time when they go home, they can have more spare time. Secondly, there should also be more parent education, and there should also be life education for students, because they have to understand that other than learning at school, parents should also set a good example, and they should be the role models for their children. There should be more education for parents, so that university professors should coordinate this, so that they will be looking at the actual situation, and there should be tailor-made courses for parents. And for NGOs, there should also be a parent-teacher association. There should also be community halls that would be used for such courses, so that parents would be able to know the importance of them acting as role models for their children and so on. And they should also understand how they can deal with their kids' negative sentiments and psychology. And that cannot be taught by textbooks. And there should be more interactive courses. And there should also be life experience sharing sessions.
So that gradually they can learn their own values, and they will know how to face failures and successes. And we should also provide more rest and provide opportunities for us children to rest. We should have parent-child function rooms with seminars and with play equipment, and also printing resources for parents. And we should also improve our playground facilities in different districts. Thank you. Lime Rock Institute, Mr. Mu Kim Wah. Thank you, Chairman. I think the topic is rather baffling. It's beating around the bush. It has not it's not focused. When we were kids, we had didn't we have exams and tests and homework? Didn't we have pressure? They will never say that it's because of the government's authority, that they have greater control of education. They are the director, monitor, as well as the successor. And socialists will say that the government has the responsibility, they should do more. Now, if the government is really good at education, we won't have a spoon-feeding TCA, BCA, associate degree and diploma, so on and so forth. If government education is so quality, our secretary won't say that the system in Hong Kong is too complicated and therefore the kids have to study overseas. Children are forced to go into a lab created by the bureaucracy. Socialists would ask that the government to provide more resources. Well, when they give the resources, they want you to be compliant, and therefore government has greater and greater control over education, and children are at their mercy. To resolve these problems, the solution can be simple. The government should release its control of education. For socialists, do not add to the government's hegemony. And we should not ask our students to blame the society, which is far from perfect. And students have to understand that they have to be resilient. To be successful in life, they can only rely on themselves, and they should learn from mistakes and accumulate wisdom. We should not rely on the government to have policies to protect themselves. I've heard the views of many deputations before me. I think they are very unhappy with our education system. They think that the Education Bureau cannot do anything. Then why do we still expect them to be able to help you in education? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mu Kim Wah. Kuo Ai-ying, the Alliance for the Rights of SEN Children. Thank you. When it comes to education, we will ask what's the point of education and learning classics. And I will always ponder what learning is about. Our children, what are they learning? They're learning mechanical copying. They have a rote learning. Have our schools taught them the right moral values and how to deal with life? They are only writing, copying, and reciting. I think it is a luxury as far as school learning is concerned, because children can only beg their children, their teachers, not to give them so much homework. They're not really getting knowledge from schools, and this is ironical. I'd like to talk about children with SEN and what do they face in schools. Many of you may not know what are children with special education needs. You might have heard of ADHD, hyperactivity, dyslexia, Asperger's disease, and autism. But how many people really know what this is about? How many schools, teachers, and children know what is meant by SEN, special education needs? Many teachers do not know what SEN is about. They may have more than 2 decades of teaching experience, and they think SEN children are just being naughty, they are causing trouble, they are not behaving, and they will rule that these children are not worthy to learn in class, and they should be punished, and they should be detained after school. So is this what school education is about? Schools have resources for SEN, but they don't know how to use them flexibly and properly. How much of the resources is spent on SEN? There may be a homework adjustment that may be useful for junior primary school kids. So by filling in the blanks, that is already homework. But the most important thing for these children is not to learn how to complete their homework. Rather, there should be training to ensure that they can learn what they are supposed to learn effectively. And such training is not available in schools. If schools can make use of resources, then these children can learn happily in schools. So, Mr. Ng, when you formulate curriculum development, you should incorporate the views or the needs of SEN. You should have personal program for SEN children so that learning can really be fun for them. Mr. Kwan, thank you. I have a tape recording for you. Perhaps you officials have heeded what the CE said. You close your eyes and you won't be able to, you won't see anything. Well, there is the PEO here. Tomorrow, the government house has an open day. Perhaps you can go and express your views there, and perhaps they're having a brainstorming session there. In Bern, Switzerland, in 2000, I visited their parliament. It was a month before Christmas, and all the children there in Children Commission were younger than 18 years old, and they are respected there. Now, we don't even have someone from the LCSD. What do children need, Chairman? Since September, LCSD, well, in the past, poor children could just take free photocopies at LCSD facilities. Now they have to pay $2 a copy. Now this is really terrible for poor parents, and you can ask LCSD how the utilization rate of computers has dropped. Now they are not increasing the fixed penalty tickets for illegal parking, but not the same for LCSD facilities. Let me tell you my story. I started off rather poor, I used to live in double bunk beds in the 1960s. We had to do our homework outside our home. We went to a shared bathroom, and we just heard that some kids suffer back problems because they had to their homes were very cramped. So you really have to provide sufficient facilities for our children. And then I went to a boarding school. Mr. Zhao Hingman, who came out to raise funds to help victims of the South Asian tsunami, he was my headmaster. We must have good examples to follow. I was the one who took secondary school place allocation examination in P6. Back then, photocopying costs were high. Now, for poor children here, it is unlikely that they have their computers. Please do not charge students who take their own paper for photocopying at LCSD facilities. Mr. Tommy Zhang, thank you. There is only one education officer here. This is very sarcastic. I think this is a policy issue and also stress arising from the system itself. And the situation is not unique to one or two schools. And if we deal with children's rights and examination and homework associated stress this way, this is entirely wrong. We have seen a spate of student suicides. While we cannot apportion the blame properly, still there is a lot of room for improvement in our system. Turning back to children's rights, Article 29 of the right said that children should education should develop each child's personality, talents, and abilities to the fullest, and should encourage children to respect others, human rights, their own, and other cultures. This is about curriculum design, and we have to ensure that the curriculum can help children to make well-balanced decisions. However, our system is such that we are putting extreme or undue stress on our children, and this has affected their ability to realize their potential and talents. The most basic principle of education should be child-friendly. And Article 31 of the Convention states that children have the right to relax and play and to join in a wide range of cultural, artistic, and other recreational activities. And the general statement of the UN right is also about the negative impacts of homework on children. The UN Convention has stressed the negative impacts of examination and schoolwork on children. Why don't we face up to the problem? Can we just allow school-based management to deal with the problem? If we do not address the system, then if we allow it to be top-down as in the past, is there room for school-based management to release parents and students from the stress? Even teachers are victims of this stress. So we must improve the whole system so as to alleviate the burden on our students so that our future generations will have the room to develop themselves. Thank you, Mr. Zhou. Mr. Tian Fong Chak from PTU. Thank you. A few years ago, I saw an advertisement at a train station from UNICEF stating that there should be 1 hour of leisure time for a child. That was very horrifying. Since when has this 1 hour been so precious for our children? Deputations talked about children resources center and parents resources center for our kids, but first of all, they need time to attend these places first. There must be right measures to release our children from their schoolwork. When we were kids, you used to have more than 1 hour. After school, we watched TV at home every day, and society progresses all the same. And how come nowadays even 1 hour of rest is so difficult? Recently, I read an administrative manual from the Education Bureau. One of the paragraphs said that schools should avoid using assessments that would deprive children of the right to learn. For instance, assessment for record purposes. Now, if we look at TSA, the Education Bureau is doing the same. Can TSA or BCA really enhance the efficiency of learning and teaching? Now, for BCA and TSA, the rationale is wrong. It cannot help children to progress.
Well, there was a report earlier on saying that if you want to collect data under the TSA in order to review the operation of the schools, and if you want to promote the effectiveness of learning by conducting this assessment, in fact, they are actually contradictory. And in the end, you can only force the schools to drill the students. So we've been saying this, and then the administration said that they'd be reviewing it. And apparently, you're using some excuses, and you're trying to change the name and continue with the old form. And also, as some have suggested, that well, for whole day school, in the afternoon, the students should have more spare time, and they should also have some extracurricular activities, or they should at least be able to do their homework at school. But then in the end, teachers can only force them to have more tutorial classes because they have to take the TSA. So have you dealt with those problems? And also for teachers and social workers, they will have to help out. But then for teachers and social workers, they are already having their hands full. Recently in our school, there's a social worker, so he's like a zombie because he has been taking care of the students all the time. He doesn't even have time for lunches and so on. So how can he keep an eye on the students' growth? All right, you have one social worker, one school, and yet if you're not able to meet that target, then how can you expect them to do more? I hope that Mr. Ng will also bring this back to the Bureau. That is, we'd like to scrap TSA for P3 immediately, and also to review the whole day school system, and also there should be a review of the curriculum, and also the staff establishment of the teachers and so on. All these need to be done. But then I'd just like to summarize that, because if you look at the parents and also for standard working hours and also family-friendly policies, you will have to unleash the ability and time of the parents so that they'll be able to take better care of their children. I think that's the most important thing. Thank you. Next, Chuang Kwan Teng. Thank you, Chairman. First, on what's meant by children's rights, I don't intend to read out the theories and so on. Well, if you just give a toy to babies, then what is going to happen? Please do not prevent them from doing this or deploying their intuition and so on. All right, if a particular toy is operated all the time, or it's very likely that there will be fatigue. So the same will apply to children. So apparently, if children play, then it's like they have committed very serious crimes. How can that be the case? And also, if you look at children's rights, these are very complicated concepts and so on. Just go back to the basics. So let's look at the current controversy. So is it that the Bureau would like to have a large number of students without any critical ability or critical thinking, or are you trying to nurture some people who would be able to have their own values and they would also have independent thinking? But are you doing this? Because if you look at students, they are actually fighting for good results every day, and this kind of distorted concepts would be distorting the children. And So in the end, they don't have friends and they are not able to establish relations and so on. I think their moral values would be the most important thing. But then under the current system, they are attaching more importance to performance than their actual virtues and also personality development. And if this is allowed to spread, then under the circumstances, then how can we allow them to develop their potential? And given the high stress that they are experiencing, then how can they enjoy their studies, and do they really know what they are learning? And also, the only result is that they are trying to meet other people's expectations, and they are going for good results, and yet they will be lost in the process. So for children's rights, I think the essence is allow them to enjoy their playtime and also develop their potential, but then it shows that there is a lot of room for improvement in Hong Kong. And if you look at the culture of drilling, I think it should be improved, and also there should be deep understanding so that people will be able to make use of their knowledge. Only then will it be effective. But then after so many years of education reforms, have you reviewed the situation? Is the current direction correct? Or is it that you are making all the wrong turns, and as a result, you're actually turning it into a vicious circle? Thank you. Mr. Ng Kong Fong. Thank you. First, I'd like to declare that I'm on disability allowance, and this is my card. I'd like to say that I have spent 12 years on grammar school, and I graduated. And then for my DSE result, in fact, my results have not been very good. In fact, it's only because of the minor adjustment to homework, I managed to get a bare pass. And then during the 10 odd years that I spent in schools, it's almost like a struggle of a trapped animal. So what I learned from school would not be very useful. I won't be able to apply the knowledge in my work. So why should I bother to learn at all? And also for IQ below 140, they should not go to grammar schools. They should go for vocational training so that they'll be able to find jobs more easily. It's not just that. What I'd like to see is that there should be class examination. So who should be exempted? All right. The student can pass a particular subject exam, then there is no need for him to take those classes in the future, so that he'll be able to spend his spare time on something else. So if he's a talent, if he's a genius, then he doesn't have to take any classes. So if he's not a genius, then he'll be able to spend more time on subjects that he would be weaker on. I don't really know whether the Education Bureau is listening to me very seriously and carefully. Looking back, in my old days, when I went to school, when I had to choose the subjects, I didn't choose them myself, and if I found problems with a particular subject, there's no way that I can turn back. So after S3, there were four elective subjects that I took: biology, physics, and also M1, Maths 1. So while I was at school, M1 was a mix of everything, and then my chemistry teacher advised me to drop it. Only then was I able to get a full pass certificate for graduation. So, Education Bureau, when will there be a pilot scheme for students so that by the time when students reach S3, they can give a certain subject a try, and if they can't make it, then they'll just drop it. What's even more important is that, many of my relatives have not been very well educated. They only have about a secondary school education. So you have to face up to the reality. And the reality is, well, Mr. Ng, it's about time. So with the development of artificial intelligence, with the emergence of AI, how can we cope with future demands? And also, we don't have any survival skills. There's been no training at all. We don't have any first aid training. We don't have any financial planning training. And many people have been indebted, and many of them have committed suicide. So this is really a horrible world. Next, Ms. Wong Ching-yong. Chairman, good afternoon, everyone. In fact, Hong Kong's education problems are very serious. And I think for schools, it's not a place that students should go to, because recently there's a survey, because 1 out of 7 students would be suffering from depression. And precisely, I've also got some very bad examples, and this is my personal experience. It's not that I've read them from newspapers and so on. Just last week, I knew that my neighbor's son, well, he's supposed to take the DSE, and he's suffering from depression. He rushed to the rooftop of his school and he attempted suicide. So I don't know if you're aware of that case. Okay, my daughter, she's at K1 and she's forced to ride. And then every time when she sees the school uniform, she would cry. She would burst out in tears. Alright, my friend's daughter is at P1, and then she's already made to write sentences, and she can only finish by 10 o'clock every evening, and she doesn't like to go to school at all. Alright, my colleague's son, well, I used to be a teacher, so my colleague's son, because he's in an elite school, and he's at high school, and last year they decided to send him to the UK for studies, and then he turned into a new person, or else he was on the verge of committing suicide. So should it be so hard for the students? So I'd just like to ask you, well, is it that difficult to learn from textbooks? Or is it that we've been adopting the wrong method to make them learn? And this wrong methodology, where has it come from? Okay, all of you who are here, you are policymakers. You formulated the policies. So how come you have allowed that to happen? How come you have allowed that to continue? Well, the existing system would be worse than what it used to be before the education reforms. Before the education reforms, I was at university. I was never required to spend a lot of time on my homework, and I could spend a lot of time on my interests. I only needed to spend little time on my homework and schoolwork, so I could spend spare time to acquire knowledge that I was interested in. But then for the students these days, they don't know, and they are forced to acquire knowledge that they don't know whether it's useful. So who has done all these? All right, you shouldn't just be listening, and you should be doing some concrete things. All right, it's been 20 years since you said you'd be listening to our views. I think you should be overturning everything. You should do it afresh. You should start from scratch. So you should adopt the original intention under the education reforms, or else you will only be forcing more students to commit suicide. It's very simple. Because just look at the BCA report. You're just classifying students into the good students and the bad students, and when they are compared against one another, so the drilling would be in accordance with the best standards. I also urge schools to go against the Education Bureau because they're wrong. You should not follow them. Please. Next, Ms. Hoi from the Social Workers Federation. Well, my surname is Hui. I'd just like to say that there is a flaw with the existing system. And with this flaw in the system, students have not been properly taken care of. Their rights have been denied. So I'd like to read out some figures. And all of them have to do with the pressure that students are experiencing under the current system. All right, the Oi Kwan Social Service Center under the Baptist Church. An overwhelming majority said that they are subjected to a lot of stress, and they have to undergo professional counseling. Some 9.7% of the students claim so. So if you take that to be the real situation, then some 50 schools will have to, a very high proportion of students will have to have professional counseling, and yet they have not been able to get that at all. Why is it the case? Because there are some students, even if they are just P1 or P2 students, they would already have suicidal thoughts, and yet they try to bury that. They try to bury that under the carpet. And what will happen if they try to suppress those feelings? They will try to tear their hair, and they just bite their own fingers. Yes, but then they would also be tearing their own eyebrow. And then by the time when they reach P6, there would be some boys who would still wet their beds at night. Why would that be the case? How come we have not been able to identify those in an early stage so that there can not be early intervention? Because while they're at school, there is no resident social workers who can do the day-to-day counseling. So what would the Education Bureau do when it comes to counseling services? All right, they have a student counselor. So you would call that student guidance personnel. All right, you're providing guidance to them. You're not providing counseling to them. Yes, students need to be guided. So the students' guidance teachers can do that. But then for the 9.7% of the students, they need professional counseling. But then we have the figures, and yet there is no response whatsoever. So assuming that we have a resident permanent social worker at school, then what can he do? All right, he can make sure that if students want to maintain their privacy, for example, between the student and the teacher, there might be something good or bad happen. All right, for example, if I fall in love with my teacher, what should I do? Should I tell the teacher? In fact, you can find someone who's neutral. He's a social worker. You can express your feelings to this social worker, but then the system is non-existent.
So we should have a regular school social work station to a school to protect the privacy of parents and students. And one important point I'd like to mention is because we do not have this regular system, school counselors suffer a lot of wastage. Students don't know about the system, and they would think that parents and social workers have deserted them, and this increased their feeling of being deserted. So we cannot set up a safety net to support our primary school children. Madam Chow Mei Mei.
Good afternoon. I am a mother myself. My child is a primary school kid. Last year, he spoke here, so he's very brave. I have learned from him. It was like he was in heaven in kindergarten, but he entered hell as soon as he entered primary school. I think what primary school children need is a genuine recess. They do not have a normal time to socialize, and we want them have enough time for a proper lunch, and they should be allowed to leave school punctually. This is very fundamental, but very often students have to attend remedial classes, and during lunchtime, class teachers may attend to class business as well. So every day, school children have a lot to cope with. They have to absorb a lot. There is no time to relax. Most of us are working adults. Sometimes we may have to work 1 or 2 over hours, over time, but there can be breaks in between. We go to washrooms. We can check with our colleagues. We can take a drink or two. We can take snacks, but that is not allowed for school children. My son told me that he wasn't really allowed to turn around to look at his classmates. So I cannot but ask, are our children in jail or in class? What we ask is very basic. We want children to have enough time to rest, to relax, to do physical exercise, to have time with parents, and at weekends and holidays, it should also be time for relaxation and not for tutorial classes and supplementary exercises. Even if we allow our children to stay idle at school, that's perfect. At home is perfectly fine, because even a rubber band needs to go loose. Why are our children so fragile? I like to draw an analogy. Children are just like seedlings. For their roots to grow properly, there must be enough room for their roots to spread. And we must allow room for them to spread their roots so that when they face life challenges, they can withstand storms and still remain erect. So for our children to grow into adults, to contribute to society, we must return the basic rights to our children. We should not let them be pot plants. We should allow them to grow into tall trees. Thank you. Ms. Zhang Yim Shin from at Parent United Hong Kong. I am Zhang Yim Shin. I censor the Bureau for not having a politically accountable officer here, and it's not fair to all of us here. I'd like to express my regret. We have done some statistics to allow parents and also members understand what's wrong with our system. Take the mathematics subject for P1 to P3 students, 164 learning objectives, and among this 142, they have to be completed in 260 hours. So there is only 1.6 hours to complete one learning goal. They need three lessons per day before they can complete the curriculum from P1 to P3. Now, this is very tight. I am not talking about Chinese and English languages yet, given that the curriculum is so heavy. And we're told that every day there should be 100 minutes of rest. Now, you tell us that children should have 1 hour of playtime per day. This is so contradictory. Some parents over there asking the Bureau to give more, to give them more power to control schools. Given the situation, you ask to give them more power, they can't even manage themselves properly. We have none from the Bureau, no secretary, no PS, no undersecretary. These policies are hard to understand. We must have an overhaul of the system. Otherwise, at Parent United Hong Kong, doesn't know what it would be about. Otherwise, parents should be allowed to choose schools we go to. I'm sure international schools will be burst to seams, and then no one will go to public schools. Why do children have to go to tutorial classes? Because you cannot have three arithmetic lessons a day. So we have worksheets, supplementary exercises, and copying, because they cannot complete the curriculum in class. So parents are asked to deal with them at home, so we can only send our children to tutorials. Teachers cannot know whether children have learned properly, because the worksheets are all the same. They can only know whether they got the questions right or wrong, so they have to assess the effectiveness of learning by tests and examinations. I still have some time left. Now, BCA, I asked Carrie Lam not to cheat students. She promised that BCA at P3 should be shelved. She has yet to set up a working group to deal with that. Now, do not deceive school children. Don't force parents to ask our children to go on strike. Thank you. Chen Yuling. I am Chen Yuling. Good afternoon. I used to attend a mainstream school. Now I have gone to an international school because I couldn't cope with the schoolwork. This is not the first time I've come here at a public hearing. I don't understand why we have to say this so many times without and to no avail. So I have to rehash it time and again. In mainstream schools, there is a lot of copying and rote learning and dictations and assessments. Even after our homework, we had to revise our schoolwork until 11 p.m. I am now attending an international school. There is only one assignment per week. Last week, I did a science assignment, and I decided how the assignment should be done. I decided to make a 2-minute short video. I spent 6 hours to do it, from research to copywriting and to prepare to put together the equipment for the experiment. And then I took a video and I edited it and voiceover and also music. I was very happy to do the assignment, and the teacher knew from the video how much I have learned. I put in a lot of efforts. I did it very well. I was praised by the teacher, and I derived a lot of satisfaction. In the past, my homework was supplementary exercises and worksheets, and also a copying vocabulary. I didn't know what it was for, and teachers didn't know what we were learning. So they had to use dictations and also assessments and tests and examinations to gauge what we have learned. We were under great pressure. Last year, I asked the Secretary for Education how come there could be happy learning in international schools and not in mainstream schools. Now, I don't have to ask the current secretary, because his children are just like me. They go to international schools. So I think he should know full well what it's all about. I hope he can ensure that students in our mainstream schools can also enjoy happy learning. Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Chen Yuling. Yes, I hope that your dream could come true. I hope all students can have happy learning. Social Service Center for Personal Development Limited, Ms. Yu Hao Chu. Thank you, Chairman. I'm Yu Hao Chu. The Social Service Center for Personal Development Limited attaches significance to child's rights, and we want all children to enjoy their rights. I think many speakers have almost taken words out of my mouth, and let me summarize in a picture. Now, we have education, we have our social aspect, and we have to consider different aspects of development. I attended a half-day school when I was a kid. I spent 3-4 hours in school. We spent 2 hours in homework at work, and we still had time to watch cartoons and TV programs. We were happy. We had room. Perhaps we have forgotten that children spend 7 hours in whole-day education. Many children come to our center to do their home assignments. Many of them have 7 to 8 assignments per day, and in some other centers, I heard that their children had 14 assignments. So you have to spend at least 3.5 hours on 7 or 8 assignments. Not everyone is so smart as to complete them in just 1 or 2 hours. So children lost the time to play. We have to bear in mind that children are still young. As Ms. Mo said, that school children have a tighter timetable than adults. Now, for an adult who works 9 hours, then for a child who has to spend 7 hours in school, homework should be confined to 2 hours so that he can have time to play. I think for the primary curriculum, it's only Chinese, English, and arithmetic. It's not complicated. I think 4 assignments should suffice. If you say that it must be 4 or 5, then there should be 1 homework lesson in school, so that by the time student returns home, he can have time to relax and play. We have asked parents and we have collected 100 signatures. Some parents have a very wrong concept. Some parents are of the view that if we cut down on the amount of homework, then children will have more time to play online games and to browse the net, and they will get addicted. I think this is very irresponsible. Children need leisure time, and parents should help them to develop their potential in their leisure time so that they will not only derive satisfaction from playing online games. I suggest that schools reduce the amount of homework that require copying and repeated corrections. And if you're worried that with less homework, the effectiveness of learning will be affected, then we can have quizzes every 2 weeks so that children can develop the habit of revising their schoolwork on a voluntary basis, because revision can help to enhance the efficiency or effectiveness of learning. Thank you. Education Forum, Mr. Wong Chi-hei, Cody Wong. I think it's expected that there will be no senior officials from the Education Bureau, because it's the same every time. I was close to tears when I listened to submissions made by deputations. Now, when the undersecretary lost a son, it was a story, but for other people who lost their children, it's just statistics. Now, I would like to make the following remarks to deputations present, and I hope the media would report what I'm going to say.
So when have we started to think that we will have to do all our homework correct? Because when I was a young kid, well, I didn't need to do all my homework correct, or else how would my teacher know how much I've learned? So what's the point of going to schools? I've been a teacher myself, I've been a tutor myself, and I'm now involved in sports because I don't want to do damage to students. So I think schools will have to change, because schools are the places where they can change the life of students. That's what education is for. And many years ago, I used to be a private tutor. And incidentally, well, many students were from the same school and was from the same class. And then the teacher called me up one time saying that, all right, tomorrow there's a test. And there are 5 chapters that I haven't finished. Please do that for me, because half of my class is in your tutorial school. So I spent half an hour criticizing him. Now, I have a student. So he has a depression, HDH, and he's also suffering from bipolar. And but then he's a very good student. And then the teacher thinks that he's not doing well in his school, and therefore he should spend all time on schoolwork, homework, and on his education and so on. So I read a chapter. I read an article from Lu Xun, and you might have read it. It's called Hong Kong Yi Ji. So apparently you are very eloquent, but then you are really rotten in your mind, and you cannot just recite the articles and also the great works of literature, and yet you know nothing about it. So even if I were a teacher, I used to be a teacher myself, I've noticed that many teachers do not understand what they should be doing. All right, actually, I understand that there's a teacher who spent a lot of time arguing with everybody, including the school headmaster, because he was very concerned about the number of strokes for a particular character. And a lot of those stress would be passed on to the parents as well. So is there something wrong with our education system? So I hope that there can be more time for discussion later. But then I'm all for reforming our education system so that we can have characteristic education from primary school. We should motivate the students, and then by high school, we should consolidate our academic achievements, and then by university, you will be training their critical thinking. So that should be what we would be thinking about. And I hope that if we still have time, we should spend more time on that. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Wong Chi-hei. Next, we have Sandy Chow from the Level V-Act, or Love V-Act. All right, for secondary and primary school students, they will have to get up at 6, and then they'll have to spend 6-7 hours a day at schools, which is very intensive, and most of them will also have to go to private tutorial schools after classes, and then by the time when they go home, there's still a lot of homework to do. Well, setting aside the tests, examinations, and so on, they have no time for themselves. I have 3 kids, ages 12, 8, and 4, and every day they have at least 10 assignments, and then weekends there would be several dozen. So they can't finish them, and by this summer, my second son has been diagnosed with dyslexia. So for Chinese, English, and mathematics, he has dyslexia, and he can't speak well. And he has also got reading difficulties. So when he listened to his classes, he's no difficulty, but then he has difficulty completing assignments. So most of the time, he can't finish his homework, and therefore, he's very resistant to learning, and he doesn't want to go to school at all, and he would rather not to go out to play at all. And starting from this year, I change get another school for him, so he goes to another school so that there would be less homework. Still, there would be 7 to 10 assignments, and then during weekend there would also be 10 assignments. I continue to talk to the teacher, telling him that my kid needs a further adjustment, but then according to the feedback from the teacher, even after receiving the report, he still insists on requiring him to do the homework, and he said that alright, the standard of the school is already lower, and if your kid can do it, he should try his best to complete all the assignments. So I can see that he's dozing off while completing his assignment. So even if I push him, I find it hard to do it because he has dozed off. And then on one occasion, he was so tired. And I told him that, alright, I've talked to the teacher, so you would only be spending 45 minutes on your assignments, and it's okay. But then he said, Mom, well, if tomorrow I can't submit my homework, so it would be me who would be suffering, not you. So I was very helpless because I couldn't do anything about it. And after discussing with my husband, all we can do is to try our best so that he'll complete his homework as best he can while he is at school. And then afterwards, he won't be required to do anything else. I think he should finish everything at school. And if he can't finish it, then the teacher should make adjustments so that he can make sure that the student can complete his work. So that's the purpose of going to school. Einstein once said that, what is education? Education is whatever you learn at school. Even if you forget everything, you will still be able to acquire something, and that's what education is for. Thank you. Thank you, Sandy Chow. Colleagues, I received a motion from Shuka Chun, and I think this is also very relevant to today's discussion. And while we have a close to full quorum here, so I'd like to deal with that first. So, Mr. Shuka Chun, can you explain or read out your motion? Well, is that this subcommittee urges the Education Bureau to review the content of the homework guideline and also its effectiveness, and it should also consider setting out first the maximum homework hours, and number two, that on Friday, schools should be required to give out the normal homework load as weekdays, and third, there should at least be one long weekend or long holiday during which schools would not be giving out any homework, and then students should enjoy genuine autonomy. Mr. Yip Kin Yun, I support the motion moved by Mr. Xiu Ka Chen, but then if you look at the wording of the motion, it's very restrictive. Well, it might be at odds with the current management system of schools, and therefore, I'll be abstaining when it's put to the vote. But then I think in terms of the spirit and the direction, I think it's something that I can support. Thank you. Okay, so anything else from other members on this motion? If not, then I'll be putting it to the vote. Will those in favor please raise their hands? Okay, so this motion is carried. Mr. Yip Kin Yun abstains. Okay, so let's continue with our motion. Next, Ms. Wong Lok Yin from the Children's Rights Committee. Yes, my name is Shelley. Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'm speaking to talk about the problem of the pressure put on to students by schoolwork and examination. In fact, supposedly there is a guideline from the Bureau, but then it makes it clear that the performance is something that the schools should be concerned about, and therefore they would be trying their best to enhance the performance of students. According to the definition, other than school performances, they would also be looking at other aspects of the students. But then apparently they would be looking at their capability and achievements and so on, and the guideline would be attaching more importance to academic performance as to sleep quality and so on. Those would not be taken care of, and therefore by good quality, I think it's a very important thing. But then in terms of assessing the schools, why is it that they would only attach importance to the academic performance of students rather than other aspects? And that would also affect the school's reputation, their ranking, and also their enrollment of students, and that would put a lot of pressure to bear on the schools, and in turn, that would also be passed on to students, and that would also further enhance the competition culture. So why can't we attach more importance to the well-being of students? Why do we have to measure the school performance of the students? Why can't we also measure their sleep time and also rest time and so on? Going back to basics, so what's the point of doing the assessment? Is it that between the schools and between the students there needs to be more competition? Is it to enable the schools to better understand the school life and also their lifestyle so that more adjustments can be made? If it's for the latter, then the most important thing is to ask the students what their experience is instead of just concentrating on their academic performance. Other than distributing this stakeholders' questionnaire, there should be more chances for the schools to join in expressing their views of students' campus life and so on. All right, for this approach, this is nothing new. For example, in Australia, the Education Authority would also be setting up the well-being framework for schools, which emphasizes that schools should allow students to have more choices so that they can develop their potential better in order to enhance the well-being of students. And then what they measure would not just be the performance of the students, but also and also the school's ranking, but then whether or not there would be autonomy for the students to have more room for development. Indeed, some speakers have also said that there should be more rest time and more leisure time, and the purpose is to allow the students to have more choices so that they can decide as to how they're going to spend their leisure time. We are not trying to make sure that students will be achieving their best by making use of every second and minute. In fact, by setting up the Children's Commission, we hope that all the government departments relating to children will also be thinking about this. They should start from the perspective of children, and there should be mechanism which would be children friendly, and they would be looking at things from the children's perspective. Thank you, Shirley. I'd like to remind members that we should be ending by 5, and yet we still have 12 deputations who would like to speak. And if everybody is given 3 minutes, then that would take at least 30 minutes. So please do grab your time. Yes, Ms. Ng Ting Wai. Thank you, Chairman. Well, I'm a children counselor in 2017. Well, today we are here to discuss the rights of children amid examination and schoolwork stress. Well, since May last year, we have already got some 70 cases of children suicide. And if you look at the ultimate survey, it says that the suicidal rate in Hong Kong has been lower than other countries, for example, Australia and Finland. But then if you look at the causes, they are very different from ours. For example, there might be alcoholism and also crime-related causes. But then in Hong Kong, most of the cases are related to school-related pressure. And also, according to reports, that's because of emotion and also stress control and so on. Well, that might not be directly related to schooling and so on. And according to the report, many of the recommendations are just a band-aid approach. For example, schools would be providing more support, and also social workers would be providing more support and so on. So these are just band-aid approach, and they are very fragmented, because that would also put more pressure to the children, and they might think that they are lost and they don't know what to do. Well, while they are developing the potential, there should be more room for them to try out different things so as to determine their lifelong goal. Well, yes, there might be employment services, for example, there would be new curriculum, and also there would be more pathways for students, but then the Education Bureau has not made any changes to this. And also in 2017, the chief executive also said that they would be popularizing vocational training and so on. But then if you look at the situation in Hong Kong, most people think that if you're able to have achievements academically, you would be regarded more highly in society. And therefore, we should enhance their confidence in vocational training curriculum. For example, in DSE, if vocational training can only get a mediocre grade, nobody would have interest or would recognize it. And therefore, there should be more safeguards so that stakeholders would have greater confidence in that, so that there would be more long-term development. All right, death is something that everybody fears, and some people say that suicide is a knock-on effect because of the widespread atmosphere in society. That's why people would take their own lives. In fact, nobody would give up their own lives if they have other alternatives. And therefore, we should be concerned about children's suicide problem, and we should find out the cause of the problem and find a solution. For example, we should review class time and also the curriculum so that there would be genuinely more diversified pathways for students, so that that would ease the pressure, so that we won't have so many tragedies. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Mr. Sam Kai Hong. Good afternoon, everyone. We have heard so many people say many things, and many people are saying that there's a lot of stress. In fact, I'm a student under the current education system. I'd like to reflect to you how I feel about the pressure. All right, excessive examination has been a problem all along. The administration has been saying that there'll be whole person development, and yet this is also a source of pressure. In particular, when students and also parents are subject to a lot of pressure from schools, they have no choice. It's not about time management, but then students simply do not have enough time to cover so many things.
When it comes to examination, there is a TSA and now BCA and also promotional examinations. Now, people are saying that TSA is too difficult, and learning is about learning examination skills, and the essence of education is lost. In Asia, we attach a lot of significance to academic results. Many people think that good academic results are everything. If you go to a good school, then you get the world. So whether it be primary and secondary schools, we are all going for good academic results. Many people give up their time to relax and play for the sake of good results, and tutorial schools are multiplied by a large consortia, and school children are sometimes perfectionists, and they face increasingly high stress. So learning is not funny, and the ambience is not good, and this will affect their motivation to learn. The government has done a lot of remedial measures, including a career and life planning, but this has added to their stress. When they cannot think of their life goals, if they cannot attain them, this is another source of stress. They have no time to explore and to find their interests. As we all know, stress is not easy to resolve, so we should start at source before we can address this problem. And we have to teach according to a child's talents. I am among the desperate group. My life is all in a mess because of education. I feel pressure in all aspects of life. I agree that a certain kind of stress is good, but if you have gone beyond the threshold, then this is no good. This is what vicious competition is about. I think all children should lead meaningful lives, and we should help students with other abilities to have other kinds of development so that we can lower the pressure from education. Ms. Isabella Lee, I am a member of Children Commission in 2017. I think everyone should be entitled to dreams. Now, some may want to be a bus driver or a carpenter. You may think that is meaningless. And even career, that are not so-called noble should be respected, but adults think otherwise, and children have to aspire to become lawyers and doctors, regardless of whether they want it or not. They have to give up their interest to please adults, and that's why children are under such pressure, and this explains the spate of suicides we have. Well, this is all because our education system is all about consumerism. If you cannot get good academic results, you don't have a future, you cannot get into a good secondary school and then good university. So parents and schools drill their children with examinations and homework, and your examination scores will determine your future. This is the crux of the matter. And schools only teaching examination skills, and their room for development is stifled. They cannot realize their potential and develop their own future. In other countries, children are allowed to do what they like to do. They're given a lot of room to meditate, to relax, and then they can also be exposed to different areas of knowledge. They can have room to practice and to experience what they have learned. Well, I think we should be allowed to take up any career we like, and we in other countries, they focus on practical knowledge and not just book learning. Our education system is still very traditional. Although we have a higher diploma as an additional choice, but the recognition is low for such qualifications. So it's quite rare for students to pick up professional vocational learning. Last year, an International Avian Academy was set up in Hong Kong. I think that's a good beginning, so that we can have another choice for our children. Unfortunately, there are only 80 places, insufficient to meet demand. There should be more such programs so as to widen the horizon of students, so they will not only aim at entering universities. Then we can set right the current misconception. We so that children can find interest in their learning. And this is already a pressing matter, and we must address it as soon as possible. The government must review it. Thank you, Ms. Li Qiyan. Ms. Chen Yu Ban, asking for balance of play and homework. Good afternoon. I'm a P4 student. I'm here, and you understand that I am a primary school children living a child under great pressure. I have at least 8 to 10 assignments every day. I have to apply a lot of mental effort, and I can't afford to be lazy. There is a homework support group in school to help us to complete our homework. There is usually a mentor, a big brother or big sister to teach us. There is only 1 hour for 10 kids, and so when I have assignment that I don't know how to do, it's hard to get a chance to ask because the class size is too big. However, it's still better to do our homework in school than at home, because our flat is very small. At home, I have to work on my bed using a very small desk. And sometimes I will have to pile my books on my bed, and it's really cramped. If I do my homework in school, there is more room. At least I don't I won't have my desk stacked on my books. If you ask me how I can see pressure relieved, I hope Mr. Young from the Education Bureau can limit the number of assignments per day to 5. And when I don't know how to do my homework, there can be someone to help me. I want to have a better environment to do my homework. When can my dreams come true? Thank you, Ms. Chen Yuban. Mr. Yang? Yes. Perhaps he is listening at a certain corner. All right. Mr. Lai Pak-yin, good afternoon. I hope Mr. Young would not let students down. I am a member of a concerned group of young suicides. I'm also a frontline social worker in school. I dare not say that I understand children very well, but still I live with 500-600 school children every day. I can describe our children with one word, busy. They are very busy. They are busy in school, at recess. I have this book from a school library, Men Are Born Equal. This is about human rights, and the children next to me has just read it. So what is meant by free? Do people have time to be free? The biggest problem with our young people to exercise their right is they don't have time. They don't have time to choose. They are controlled by others, especially for primary school children. They have everything arranged for them. They don't have time to manage their own lives. They have not enough time to sleep. 9 hours is a luxury. That is really a very basic standard. They have no time to do their revision and to be idle. Why? Because the time they spend and learning is far too long. After school, they go to tutorial schools, and then they do the homework. They have to get to a good secondary school, so they have to spend time learning and to brush up their CV. This is a very ridiculous logic. They spend the time in incessant learning. They have to have a time to address the learning, and when stress is high, they pile up, the pressure pile up. So the amount of stress experience is packed to their workload. Can we have standard learning hours for students? From October to now, we did a survey. Many respondents, over 60% of the respondents were students. The others were teachers, social workers, and parents. 94% of the respondents supported standard learning hours, and their proposal is 7 hours a day. Of course, we've submitted the report to the Education Bureau, and we also asked for a meeting with the Bureau where we can elaborate on our report. And when Mr. Young, the secretary, met us, he said that it was really new, something interesting. No, in fact, children should not spend their time learning. They should have time to play and to relax. Thank you. Ms. Wong Yun Ai from the group Children Are Not Children. I am Wong Yun Ai. I'm a P6 student. I am under extreme pressure because of the assessment for S1 place allocation. Compared with P3 and P4 when the learning atmosphere was much relaxed, much more relaxed. We are under great pressure now. After I return home, I have to complete my homework until 7 or 8 p.m. If unfortunately there is composition, I have to work on it until 9 p.m. after dinner. I have a friend who lives in Shanghai, who lived in Shanghai, but he has now moved to Yunnan, and he spent 1 hour traveling from Yunnan to Shanghai for school. He gets up at 5 a.m. every day. He doesn't get enough sleep because after extracurricular activities after schools, it will be 7 p.m. when he returns home, and it will be 11 p.m. when homework is done. He may not have time to do any revision, and then he gets up at 5 a.m. again. So he doesn't has the energy to be attentive in class. I suggest that we shorten the school time so that there will be more time for rest and for sleep, so that people can be more energetic. If you don't have enough energy, you just cannot absorb what your teachers tell you in class. Thank you. Thank you. I'm Sister Chen Kalong. Thank you. I'm a university student. Now I am. I have a 1 week semester break. And last year I was an Essex student. I came to speak in that capacity. A year has passed and nothing has changed. Students still face a lot of homework stress. Since last year, 75 students have committed suicide, regardless of how many public hearings you have and how we are shouting is useless, because the Education Bureau has deflected from the original spirit of education. Carrie Lam, in her campaign, promised to abolish BCA, and I think she has changed her position. The purpose of assessment is to see whether students have acquired the skills for TSA and BCA. They killed students' interest in learning. So when learning is a labor, there must be stress. There must be room for students to think and to learn. And if our system is exam-oriented, then things can't change.
But then these schools, because they are concerned that they might be closed, and therefore they will strive to have their students perform, and they will continue to drill them until they perform well. But then individual students are very different, and therefore you should not be measuring everybody with the same yardstick. And that would be against eclectic learning, and you would only be determining whether or not you are capable by your scores. And in order to achieve political objective, you're actually increasing the substance or the content of the curriculum, so that teachers will have to teach a lot of things within very limited class hours. But then some of these might not be necessary. For example, you will have to teach Southern China and also how Hong Kong was placed. In fact, Hong Kong was at the periphery of Southern China, and why should they teach that as a separate item? And also there would also be teaching based on the basic law. It's not going to benefit the students. In fact, that would only increase the pressure of the students. And if students have to acquire so much knowledge within such a short space of time, and they would also have to compress other class times, and then our teachers will also have to rush through all the curriculum, in the end, it's definitely the students who will be suffering instead of the education officials who have designed such curriculum. We hope that there can be genuine improvement by easing the pressure of the students instead of having the officials doing this in air-conditioned offices. And also, you've also attended other activities. You've actually planned the future for the students. In fact, that would not improve our education system. We hope that we won't wait until problems have emerged before we would take remedial measures. In fact, the Education Bureau should promise that the P3 BCA should be scrapped so that there can be a comprehensive review of the system instead of attaching importance to drilling and rote learning. We should attach importance to the workload of students. There should be no copying. The most important thing is to give the students back a leisure time so that they can have more rest, because it doesn't belong to schools. It doesn't belong to the Education Bureau. It belongs to the students themselves. Thank you. Ms. Jun Hyo Lam from Students with SEN. In fact, students are suffering, and for those who have needs, that is SEN students, they would be suffering even worse. In fact, we've been having meetings with parents of these students, and most of them are at P1, P2, and most of them are grassroots. And recently, we have introduced integrated education, but then whether or not these children's potential can be developed and so on. Very often it has to do with the education system and also how schools are implementing these measures. But then if you look at the papers, in fact, they have actually shirked the responsibility. They say that the problem of heavy workload is a problem of individual schools, and they have not implemented education reforms, and they have no understanding of the needs of the SEN students. And in fact, the teacher standards also vary, and as a result, these children have an even harder time. And for SEN students, school environment and also their classes and also homework arrangement, to them there is a lot of restriction, because according to a parent whose son is an SEN student, he's not permitted to run during school breaks, or else he would be denied lunches, and he will have to sit well in classes, and only after school can he do a round of runs in parks, and then he will have to finish homework until 10 p.m. in the evening. So how can is it an isolated problem with the schools? And when it comes to examination, SEN students will be even more will have even greater difficulties. All right, there have been guidelines by the Education Bureau and the schools in determining whether or not adjustments can be made. They will also have to hand it over to the EP, and there is a shortfall of such a psychiatrist, and therefore they are not able to do this. And even if they are able to do it, there would also have to be a meeting organized by the meeting, and parents and also teachers of the students would also have to decide it at a meeting. But then in reality, very often the schools would just issue a circular, and they would just be informing the parents without really discussing with them. And also there are HDH students and so on. But then because there is no education psychiatrist this year, and because of that, they've also not arranged for students to choose the subjects and so on. And you can imagine the kind of stress and also the feeling of loss by the parents. So you will have to respect the children's rights to examination and so on. Earlier on, I also talk about BCA's arrangement, and according to some representatives, all right, his kid has already taken that examination. I found it strange because his kid was only a P2 student, but then schools are already beginning to drill the students when they are at P2. In fact, it's not just one or two papers that would require drilling. In fact, for drilling on students, in fact, one would be one too many. And therefore, I hope that the Bureau will immediately review an integrated system so that there can be more collaboration between the schools and the parents, and they could also review the arrangement on adjustment of homework so that students can also be able should also be able to join the work of the Children's Commission in order to develop better health for them. Next, we have Ho Yu Ying. Thank you. All right, I've brought with me a picture, and this young child is kneeling down, and he's using a bench as a table, and then he's doing his homework, and the background is not his home. It's also not his school. It's at a hospital. So this parent WhatsApp this picture to me, and this is a P4 student. He's been having a flu for a few days, and he went to the hospital to see a doctor. So while he was waiting for his turn, he had to be on his knees, and then he would have to do his homework on the bench. And very often he would ask his mom to send a WhatsApp to me to ask questions about his homework. Sometimes it's 6, 7 p.m. Sometimes it's 8 or 9 p.m. But then more often it's 10, 11 p.m. So it's about time for me to go to bed. And yet this child is still concerned about how he has to do his homework. And I was asking, how come he's doing his homework at the hospital? Why can't you tell the teacher that you're sick and therefore you can't finish your homework? No, the the kid said he would be scolded by his teacher if he told the teacher that he's sick. So is it that doing homework is everything and is more important than your own health? So what kind of education are we offering the children? So what kind of environment are we providing them? They are spending 7-8 hours at school, and then after school they will have to do homework, and if they are not able to do it, they will have to spend even more time on it. But then the purpose of education is to allow students to finish their homework at school with the support of teachers. But then obviously we have not been able to do that at all. And if we are not able to do it, then whose fault is that? Who should be held responsible? Does the Bureau have any responsibility? The Bureau often says that there are guidelines for schools and so on. But what we have seen is that 8 out of 10 schools have flouted these guidelines. So what's the point of having these guidelines in the first place? And yet, what has the Bureau done? I'd like to listen to the Bureau so that they give us their side of the story. So these schools have flouted the guidelines, and what can be done about it, and what have you done? Okay, every child should be protected under the Convention of Children's Rights. This is their right. I hope that everybody will take up this responsibility to protect our children so that their mental and physical health can be protected so that they can grow up healthily. Thank you. Thank you. Next, Ms. Ho Si Wai, who is the NGO Youth Policy Advocation platform. It's not just about homework that students are having a lot of pressure from. In fact, we're talking about mainstream education. It's about mainstream learning. They will have to do their schoolwork in order to meet the requirements, and also they will have to do it at grammar schools. But then if you attach so much importance to academic performance, then what about those underachievers? Well, you can say that there is vocational training, there are programs, there are apprenticeship programs, and so on. But then if you look at that, if you're taking vocational training, in fact, the admission rate is less than 10%, and also by the time when they apply for universities, these would not be considered by the universities. And if you look at the score, they would often get a lower score than their grammar school counterparts. And also schools would not be publicizing this, because some 70% of these junior high school students are not aware of that. So they don't know that they have this choice. So the Education Bureau says that there is a diversified pathway. But then it's not the case, because for the underachievers, this is a concentration camp for them. So they would think that they are second class, and they are substandard, and they will be suppressed. And while they should be developing their potential, they would be suppressed by the system. So you should review what you have done. Is it possible for you to say that for applied learning, the importance could be enhanced instead of having a two-year curriculum? Can that be enhanced or increased to 3 years so that they can be on a par with the grammar school curriculum? You should also be telling the schools that that's something that you have to consider instead of having a choice as to whether you'd like to consider it. This is a score that you will have to take into account. And also, they should also be treated on a par with CAT A students, because you say that it's diversified pathway. And also in Germany, they have a dual track system. Under the curriculum, the schools, the employers, and also the government will be designing the curriculum together so that the curriculum's practicality would be recognized. And it's not just grammar schools. For example, there can be PE schools and also art schools and so on. So why is it that those would not be discussed? Because you're talking about diversified learning. So all I'm trying to say is that, well, there are many young people. Well, they would feel this helplessness, and that would be taken with them to tertiary institutions. Because if you are an underachiever, all right, they have their wrong strengths and weaknesses. But then, at very young days, they would have to undergo a tutorial training so that they would be the same as their counterparts and peers. And then, if they are not able to do well, then they would think that they are substandard, they are inferior, and they would just find casual jobs. With low pay and also long working hours. But then, when compared, they've been labeled as the useless youth. Is that the case? So I hope that the Bureau will review the the education system, how the assessment system is done, because that would not just affect the young students, that would also affect the young adults. I don't want the education system to be a system which would be the bottom line to test inability of students. So either they will be the upper class or they will be the grassroots, and they will have to be determined to take up the negative labeling. Is that fair to them? So I hope that the Bureau will review the system. So what kind of system do we want? How can we help the youth to develop their potential so that they can have their own personality and strengths? All right, it's close to 5 now. So I'm afraid I have to extend the meeting. So can I extend it by 20 minutes? If it's not a problem. Okay, Ho Suk Yi. Thank you. Good afternoon. All right, it's towards the end of the meeting. And after listening to so many deputations, I'd like to say that today's views are very lopsided with regard to homework pressure and also how our children's rights have been deprived. We all believe that is a big problem. Well, I don't know, after what we have said today, will that be able to have an influence or impact on society as a whole? So, for example, will the records of today's meeting be passed on to the Education Bureau? There are many committees, for example, BCA, they have a quality review committee. They also have a suicide prevention committee. All right, their views would be very different from ours. For example, they would think that BCA is something that is supported by many parents, and then by drilling one or two assignments, it's not a problem at all. But then what we have said today would be exactly the opposite of what they think. So how can we have a fair or balanced way of discussing the issue instead of having the Bureau say that, alright, on their side, the views are also lopsided. So is there a chance that the records of today's meeting can be passed on to the official committees under the Education Bureau? That's point number one. And I'm a parent working for a voluntary agency. That is the Love We Act. We have 150 plus parents with SEN students or SEN children. I'm very pleased today that there are other groups that are also concerned about the SEN students, because for SEN students, when they're placed in a mainstream school, it's double jeopardy, because for mainstream schools, as we all know, well, for average or general students, they are already facing a lot of pressure from their curriculum. But then for SEN students, they are not just facing such pressure because of their learning approach. They would be facing even more difficulty because they have to adapt to the uniform system, and it would be hard for them to make achievements. So the pressure on them would be even greater, and it's more obvious in mainstream schools. Some might say that SEM students would get a lot of education support at mainstream schools. But what I can say is that this kind of support would be straitjacketed or compressed by official resources. For example, if you have to undergo assessment, it would take 1 or 2 years before you can get the assessment, and before the report is out, you will not be getting any support at all.
And even if the assessment report is submitted to the school, because our resources are limited, then at most the kind of support you get is, now if for a child with Asperger's disease, you may have one session of speech therapy a month. And if you want to join a social skill group, it will also be rather infrequent. If Carrie Lam claims that she values education and she would like to review the 8 big areas of education, she must review our basic education and second integrated education. At least these two things are very important for our children, so that she can honor her undertaking that she will value education. Miss Gloria Chen. We have received views from Zhang Kuan O and two more areas. We have 190 responses, 170 primary school children parents indicated that their children spent on average 1 to 3 odd hours on school, and 170 odd of them said that 50% of the students spent 2 to even 3 hours on homework. I have brought along views from friends with children. I'd like to share with you. A P2 child said that he wanted more matching exercises so he could spend less time. He wanted more time for playing Lego, handwork, and arts. He wanted longer recesses, and there should be one empty lesson for play in school. And other child wants 3-day weeks, a longer Christmas vacation, and 2 home assignments a day, and he loved exams because that would mean half-day school with no homework. And other S1 student wanted more time for extracurricular activities. My son, S1 pupil, came here to a BCA public hearing last May. He complained that a friend had 5 TSA supplementary exercises on the 1st of May, a holiday. Unfortunately, Education Bureau did not follow up on that complaint. He is no longer a primary school student, but now he is in another difficulty. Now my son wants to do well in TSA. He wants to go to a good university, so he will be hired by an employer. Now, I'd like to recommend to you a radio program. Mr. Ng, please jot it down. And please do not just report to your boss, to the secretary, the undersecretary, the PS, DS, and PAS by impression. Now, this is what the Secretary for Education said on the 23rd of January 2017 in a TV program. You can browse YouTube and look for it. Thank you very much. We have many speakers today. Some are primary, some are secondary, and some are university students, and we've also got parents here. I will not spend more time on summarizing their comments, but I was very impressed to hear that once a child enters primary school, he has lost his childhood, and that a parent said that we can describe the life of a student with the word busy, and they ask for a real recess, a real lunchtime. They want to leave school punctual, and some asked for standard learning hours and maximum time spent on homework, so on and so forth. Mr. Ng, you are the principal education officer. I think you have to respond first before I give the floor to other government officials. Thank you, Chairman. I thank parents and deputations for coming to us to tell us your views. Mr. Yip, I suggest that since time is limited, 4 officials are here. By the time they have all replied, we won't have time for members to ask questions. I suggest we do it the other way around. Members should speak first before we ask officials to comment. That's good. I think I will only allow 3 minutes per member. I'm sorry, because time is really limited. Mr. Leung Yu-jong, thank you. I thank deputations for coming to meet with us on a Saturday afternoon. But perhaps for government officials, it's really a family day, so they are absent. This is really very regrettable. Many parents and young people talked about a very important phenomenon, that is the busy life of students. They have to rush from one activity to another, and parents are spurring them on from one activity to another as well. I'd like to know whether the Education Bureau is aware of this phenomenon. If yes, what ways and means do they have to improve the situation? If they aren't, how come they are not aware of the situation? Is it because in the past you've never heard of such things and you are only hearing it for the first time today? Can we ask the administration to give consolidated replies? Yes, please. I still have time. We all know that the system is the system has many problems. For instance, there is no time limit on time spent in school and on homework. Will the administration consider setting up a system? Yes, for certain things in life, there must be a system. And because there is no system, for the sake of achieving certain goals, some schools have added too many things to education, and parents and children find it hard to cope. So what is the administration's response? Mr. Yip Kin Yun, I thank the deputations for coming this afternoon, and I think what they talked about was their genuine feelings. Perhaps we may not be able to come up with a solution this afternoon, but it is important for the secretary and the PS and their team to understand the feelings of the public. At least they have raised a number of issues that have to be addressed this afternoon. I have a strong feeling that when it comes to whole day education and the amount of schoolwork, well, we first proposed a whole day education in 1997. It's been 20 years, and I think there's been some a change in the whole thing. Perhaps it is not by coincidence. Perhaps there are structural causes to this change in the nature of whole day education. And I think the Bureau should really face up to these problems. For instance, whole day education has prolonged lesson time or school time, and this is against the objective of being child-centered. As we all know, children need time to play. They need physical development. They need development at all fronts, on all fronts. And for other countries, they spend less time in school. For instance, in some countries, they've only got 5 lessons a day in primary schools, so that there is ample time for students to participate in all sorts of activities. In Hong Kong, we have additions. And it's not just by the administration, perhaps by schools, by parents as well, in the form of tutorials. There might be social factors associated. There may not be any way out if we do not find out the reason. We've always asked to reform TSA because this is the critical point. If we do not relax, if we do not do away with TSA, I think many things cannot be changed. Mr. Ng is here. I hope that we should review our curriculum for lower primary grades with due regard to characteristics of children, so that our curriculum can really be healthy. Otherwise, we're only led by the curriculum. Can you allow me to make one more point? Yes, please do so. Many speakers present are parents, and I think parents can think of ways to improve the situation. Mr. Cody Wong asked why must all assignments be correct? Many parents nowadays like to complete homework for their children to ensure that they are all accurate. But if it is due to the efforts of parents instead of their children, then teachers may receive the wrong signal and they will continue to make homework very difficult. So we should not ensure that all homework is correct. We should show the true picture to teachers so that they can adjust the curriculum. Mr. Ng. Yes, I have heard the comments of all speakers. This afternoon, I will relay these messages to my colleagues. Although Mr. Yang, our secretary, is not here, that doesn't mean that he won't know what has been expressed. I thank all deputations for their comments and suggestions. I think I will just respond very briefly. First, to follow on what Mr. Yip Kin Yun said, yes, it is correct. The parents is an important stakeholder. Has a pivotal role to play in relieving children's stress. When it comes to stress, I think many deputations have expressed their views. Mr. Ng Kin Hwa said, well, in the past, we also had stress. We all have stress. The point is how we deal with it positively and correctly. So how should we deal with it? I think different stakeholders can have different roles to play. Parents, for instance, as mentioned by Mr. Yip, and schools and also the Education Bureau should all do our part in relieving the pressure of students. Please really speed up and be concrete in your reply. When it comes to standard hours on homework and also the standard learning hours, I don't think it can easily help students to further help the outstanding students and to help the not so bright students. But they talk about a recommended number of hours to be spent on homework. Well, this is about the progress of individual students. Perhaps for some students, they don't need that much homework, and some students need more. We talk about maximum number of hours.
So is the recommended maximum hours for homework? All right, we'll go back and think about it. Yes, we have heard you. So we'll go back and think about it because we can't just say yes or no here. So we'll go back and take a look. Also on BCA, well, the chief executive already stated in her political platform during the election campaign that she would be taking a fresh look at it. And in due course, we'll be announcing what we're going to do. So I'm sure you will know it. And there are some fellow workers from the education sector saying that if they are not passing the grade, then they will have to get more drilling. No, that's not true, because the most important thing is to provide a feedback on students' learning. So I think it's in line with what you just said, we share the same objective. But what if schools do not follow your guidelines? What can you do? So, is there any role to be played by the Education Bureau? So, let's say there should be 100 minutes rest time, but then most schools are not following that. Then what are you going to do? Well, we do have a monitoring mechanism in place. For instance, our district education officers would visit the schools on a regular basis, and there would also be school inspection. So through such mechanisms, we would go to the schools to understand what is happening on the ground. For example, how their timetable operates, and if we encounter such situations warranting follow-up action, we will do it. So what about our parents? Can they file complaints? Well, there are two levels to consider this issue. As I said, parents should communicate and cooperate with schools. That's the first defense. And indeed, if you think that you cannot deal with it through that mechanism, then of course we do have an unshakable responsibility. You can come to our education officers in the district, and we will be following up on that. Thank you. All right, Department of Health and also Hospital Authority, from the health perspective, do you have anything to add? Yes, Dr. Chong? Yes, thank you, Chairman. I'll briefly respond to that. Today, we have heard a lot of comments on pressure or stress. You also cited examples as to you are in a rush. Yes, we understand that that would also have a health impact on the students or children. Whether it's the Education Bureau or relevant government departments or institutions, we do have measures and initiatives in place to help deal with this. So as the Education Bureau officer said, he'll go back and think about it. So we will see what we can do to assist him. So we will continue with that in order to help the students either have their pressure eased. All right, Dr. Yu, anything to add? From the SWD, Mrs. Squawk. In fact, I've seriously listened to the remarks made by deputations. In fact, I've got 12 pages of notes taken down. In fact, I think the atmosphere is that there are a lot of negative sentiments about the existing system. And I can also feel that amongst the students and parents, they are hard-pressed. And there are even suicidal cases, which you all feel very sad about them. So all along, we have adopted a family-oriented approach, and children are very important. And therefore, what we can do is to provide more counseling. We will see what we can do. For example, school social workers and also the family service centers and also the integrated mental health service centers and so on. So we can do a bit more in terms of counseling. And also for family life education. So while you are feeling unhappy, we hope that there would still be some room to maneuver when it comes to parental relationship. And also for after-school care and also homework guidance and also after-school support and so on, we hope that through those it can help. Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Kwok. Okay. Indeed, thank you very much for coming today. But then regrettably, the policy makers are not here. So I hope that Uncle Yang has heard you. In particular, we are grateful to secondary, primary, and even university students amongst the deputations. They have all expressed their views, and we hope that the Education Bureau will come up with a written response that will respond to the remarks made today by the deputations, including the motion that we have passed today. I hope that you'll be very serious about that. And Ms. Ho Suk-yi also suggested that also question whether or not such remarks will go to the Education Bureau, because you do have your own official consultative bodies. So, Mr. Ng, can you also tell us whether or not such remarks will be passed on to the relevant people? Yes, of course. Okay, thank you very much. Meeting is now adjourned. Thank you.